Is I think the other people should not be able to join today. So anyway, so if I look on to this people who are attending this course, of course the online mode is going to be poor only, but when I see here people are trying, people are able to browse through the materials, and of course they are able to go through the activities here. That's what I could see in terms of one day or 21. So last, people are able to go through these materials. See, it's not that they are not going through all this. So except one or two students, the other students are most likely the regular only. If you see here, at least one or two days, within the 2 days, some people are able to access the materials. They are using these materials on the course web pages. They are able to log in and at least they see it. Except this guy, the Rahul Rajput. Anyway, I'll try to contact him. If he's not able to attend, that is a different case. But except one or two guys, the others are all able to at least go through the materials that are being posted here. I cannot force them to attend the course, means onto the online course regularly. Anyway, the recorded sessions are being put forward. So please inform to your friends that there will be a minor exam on coming next Sunday. So not coming Sunday, next Sunday. And the topics, of course, will be, if you go through our syllabus, so the syllabus for the minor one, see the architecture of the IoT systems, the design principles, IoT applications, what is sensing, actuations, basics of networking, machine to machine and IoT technology, fundamentals of how the what devices and what are those called as gateways, how the data management, what type of data are there, how business processes have been held in the IoT, everything as a service with respect to the cloud and the security aspects in the cloud, followed by the unit 2, the hardware components. So already we are discussing about the Arduino and Raspberry Pi. So the ARM Cortex processors, which the Raspberry Pis are supporting. Of course, I have not covered the Intel Galileo boards, but you can keep it aside. So it should not be there. But I have covered about what is sensing and what is actuations, what are I/O interfaces, working principles of sensors and actuators, the microcontroller platforms, the software components, programming APIs. So today we are discussing about the MQTT. And the last week we have discussed about the ZigBee. So at least for up to till today, till MQTT we'll be having, and after the minor exam I'll complete the remaining, the CoAP, UDP, TCP, LoRaWAN and the 6LoRaWAN. So that completes the second unit, but except this last line and the Intel Galileo boards, the remaining all topics will be there, which are related to the unit 2. So of course this is what the syllabus. Am I clear to you, please?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So now coming to so last week we have seen how do we interface the Arduino board with the Raspberry Pi with the Node-RED. That steps of here I have given in this week 7. So you can see interface Arduino with the Node-RED. That's what we have seen, the digital temperature sensor KY08 values are being displayed on the Node-RED. So now instead of using the Node-RED, let us go with displaying the values on the Raspberry Pi itself. So now the same thing, Raspberry Pi is connected to the Arduino board using the USB serial COM port. So once you connect it, now you can always access this particular Raspberry Pi, which I have connected. And okay, see, this, if you get a server error like this, just kindly wait. It has to be connected to the server. So you'll be able to get that WebSocket green color dialog box. So once you get that WebSocket green color dialog box, then only you'll be able to access the devices here, because it is connected to a cloud server. But the Raspberry Pi is at my home location. So once you get it, Just hold on for a couple of seconds. This is going to connect to that. Okay, let it just it may take some time because it all depends on the internet bandwidth. At present, the bandwidth at my location is very low. So here you need to just wait for a couple of seconds or a couple of minutes maybe. So once it gets connected, once it gets the WebSocket is connected to the cloud server, we will come back to this discussion. And if you see the material here, again, I also kept the serial communication using the Raspberry Pi. So this is what for today's discussion. How do you connect your Arduino and the Raspberry Pi serially connected with each other, and how do you collect the data or how do you see the data? So that is the steps we need to do here. Let me refresh it again. I think there is a problem with this cloud server to get connected.
Sir, can we use Python to do the program?
Can we?
In the Violin Studio, Python, when we were trying to use it, was giving some language incompatibility error.
Language incompatible error. Basically, you are trying to code here. So it depends on what application you are going to do. The different boards, different programming languages, they have been implementing. Yeah, now see here it is connected. You can access this NKS Pi 1. I'll just show you once. After that, you can do it here. Now I connected to Raspberry Pi. That is Pi 1, and I will make this available to you. And also, may I request Anurag? I think you have one Raspberry Pi with you, right?
Yes, sir.
So you can also make available to this particular. You can connect your Raspberry Pi to the cloud so that other students can also use that Raspberry Pi. Is it possible for you to keep Raspberry Pi on from your side?
Right now it's not possible.
No, right now it's okay, but later.
Yes, later I'll try, sir.
I will tell you how to make it available so that at least 2 to 3 Raspberry Pis will be made online so that other students can start practicing on this Raspberry Pi. That is my intention here. If anybody else is having any Raspberry Pis with you, you can also make your Raspberry Pi available to access to others also.
Raspberry Pi 4.
Yes. So Pranav, you can also make your Raspberry Pi available to others.
Sir, should we install something on Raspberry Pi?
Yes, I'll tell you what to be done and make it available. Like this, you can you can connect Raspberry Pi. I am making my Raspberry Pi available to you all to do some practice on this. So like this, we can make our own Raspberry Pis. At least I am expecting some 4 or 5 Raspberry Pis if they are made available. then most of the people can access these Raspberry Pis and do some programming on this and understand a little bit of it. Is it okay? So yeah, I'll tell Anurag and Pranav, both of you, what to be done, I'll tell you after the session is over. So just listen here, what I'm doing here, first timing, and because this is the first time you're seeing, it will be new to you, and it will be a little bit confusion also will be there, but just a very simple things we'll start with. So I am making my Raspberry Pi available to you, so you can go to the shell and you can get the shell prompt here, and you can start programming completely over here. So again, this is been connected through the WildRodan cloud server. That is the thing which we have been happening here. So let me just show you the programs what we okay, now go to that material, serial communication. I'm just explaining to you. So the first step is you need to simply run ls /dev/tty*. So can anybody tell me what does this ls/dev/tty* gives you?
List of all ports.
So ls slash dev. Are you able to see my commands here?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So these are all the ports that are available onto the Raspberry Pi. Of course, the Raspberry Pi is connected with an Arduino board in a USB serial connection. Can you tell me which is that serial port which has been connected to the Arduino board? Please, all of you, look into this TTY ports first.
ACM0 TTY.
Yeah, ACM0, you can see here, this is what your ACM0. If you are not sure your Arduino board is connected to which particular port, that step also I have given here. If there is no port which has been connected, how to identify which particular port the Arduino is connected? You can see first, you can just issue this command ls, list all the ports that are which is available onto your Raspberry Pi device. At present, you can see because it is connected, you can see this one ACM0, TTY ACM0. Now I will unplug the Arduino board and again I'll run the command. So I have unplugged the Arduino board now. Again, I am issuing the command. Now, can you see whether ACM0 is there or not here? The missing port here, the previous thing on the. So here ACM0 is not present here. It is AMA0. AMA0 is another port here. So ACM0 is missing here because the port is not connected at all. So let me connect once again, connect back the Arduino port. And again, I run here. So now you will get back the ACM0 again. Once again, let me just, because the screen is very down here. So once again, I'm running it here. You get it ACM0 again here. So your Arduino port is connected to ACM0 port. That's what you can easily identify. So that steps I have given here, please go through that in the material. Now, sometimes you may not be able to get some problems because there is going to be a serial connection errors are going to come. It means your permission is denied. Like if you see the last week, Deepika, when she is showing the that particular Arduino board connection, Arduino IDE, when she was trying to run it, the permission was denied. So similar kind of errors may come because you are not been allowed to use the port. So to make the port to be allowed to read some data on the port, you need to give the permission. So here the permission is you need to add the username. So can you tell me who is what is the username of this at present the Raspberry Pi?
Pi.
Yeah, the Pi itself is the username here. So the command to be the user Pi has to be given access to this particular port. So here, how do I give that particular command? I just see the command here, the command which I am giving here. So yeah, so here sudo add user, the name of the user is py, and it is given to use the dialog. So a dialog is a group which will enable to access your ports. All these ports are there made available here. So once you give this particular command, okay, now the already, because I have given py is already a member of dialog group, so it is showing that the user py is already a member of dialog, so it has got the permission to use this particular port. So this user py can access the data from this particular USB port. So that's what the meaning here. So you can get the more information, you can just see here. So now coming to this, install the Python serial library on Raspberry Pi. So you need to install a libraries so that you can read the data on the Raspberry Pi using the programming language Python. So you can use it here for the command Python 3. So if you see, already Python is been installed here. Python 3 is been installed on this Raspberry Pi at present. So that's why you're able to Python 3.7.3. So once your Python is installed, your Python framework is installed, one library is required. That library is PySerial to read the serial port data. So if I give the command again, I'm just taking the same command, Python using the pip. I'm trying to install the PySerial. Of course, it is already installed, but you just see what, when I run the command, what is going to be shown here. Yeah, Python install PySerial requirement already satisfied, because I already installed it. It says the requirement only. If not, otherwise then the PySerial package is going to be installed. So these are the steps you need to do it on your own Raspberry Pis for you to install it. So once it has been installed, if you have not have the pip, then you can install the pip also, Python 3 pip framework. Python the pip stands for your packages, inline packages to be installed. So you can write your own Arduino codes, then you can play with this. Can you tell me what is the code which is written in the Arduino board in the last week's class discussion, if you can remember? Hello.
So temperature data.
Yes, the temperature sensor data, if you can, that particular program is also I have made available to you here. If you see this temperature sensor data collection, so this is in this video, it is there. I think that is, I have not uploaded it. I will upload that particular value. Just hold on. Yeah, digital temperature sensor data. If you remember, this is a program. LED 13, the digital pin, and digital pin is being 2, then you are reading the data, the analog value, and you are printing that analog value onto this. This is the value here. So can you remember what is the output that you are getting over there for this program? You can see this video and you can tell me the same output you are getting on the Node-RED also. Can you please remember the last class, what was the output that we are getting here?
Between 0 and 1.
Sorry? The digital value you are getting as 1, but what are the values for these analog values, for the analog value of the temperatures?
Values between 0 and 1023.
No, it is not values between 0 and 1023. No. Of course, values between 0 and 1023, what were those values? If you can remember, two times I have shown those values to you.
So we got something in 200s.
Very good, very good. Good remembrance. So you got something on the 200, very good. So same thing, but here, that was the scene, those values were seen on the Node-RED. So without Node-RED, you are doing something on this Raspberry Pi directly now. So how do we do that one is, how we will write a Python program here. So the Python program, the earlier one is without writing the program, that is using Node-RED, we have done it. So now let us see that particular program. How do we write the program here? So tell me, what are the basic steps that needs to be written on this Python program. Yes, please. How to read a data from the serial port? What are the basic steps?
We need to import PySerial library and
we need to import the import a library. Okay, fine.
Then you have to begin the serialization.
Sorry?
Begin the serialization.
Yes. So here you are importing a program, a library called Serial. Once you install that PySerial package, you can directly use this serial. Then you are creating an object serial by using this particular method serial, and the serial port, what is a serial port which is connected? Your Arduino board is connected to USB 0. If you have seen that previously, that USB Arduino which is connected to the USB 0 is to the dev TTY ACM 0. And what is this 9600 indicates?
Baud rate.
The baud rate which has been set. So you are setting up this serial object, and this serial object is trying to see, of course, this is in, you are keeping in the while true. While true implies what? What is the meaning of while true implies?
Infinite loop.
It is in the infinite loop. It is continuously reading the values from the serial port here. And one, how do you read the values from the serial port? You are using the read line method. So these are the steps that we have been done on that day already. If you remember it in the last week, you can please go through the Python program what you have done it. And what are the what are the serial port value which you have been read through that serial port is been printed here. So this is a very simple program. And in the during the discussion, I also asked you, how do we store the values here? So of course, this whatever it is, the red value is there, that is using the UTF-8. It means the values has to be displayed onto this one. So, and that corresponding values. If you want to store the values on the file, that's what, if you remember, I think Pranav has given that answer. To store that values in the file, you can use the file handling, the file which is opened in the append mode. You are going to write that values to the file. Of course, that exercise I'm not done here in this small example. You are trying, just we are trying to understand how do we run this particular program using this Raspberry Pi connected to the Wildwood in cloud server. So that's what we are seeing here. So once we have written this same program that you have seen on the Raspberry Pi, so now you, everybody knows that you how to enter the program here, right? Your Unix programming, all those things stuff will come into picture here. So once you prepare your program, you can write, you can execute this. So issue the command. You run the program, your Python program. So now you can see here, I am able to read the values here now. Same thing like which is there in that, you may remember the digital value 1 and followed by the digital temperature analog to digitally converted values. This 212, 213, 214, the same values. Of course, I'm not storing the values here. But this is how you can just simply write the program. Means you are collecting the data. Sensor data is being collected from your Raspberry Pi, which is again integrated with your Arduino board. And you are getting the actual sensor values here. All these are your sensor values. So using your Raspberry Pi, you are able to do this thing. So it is in a continuous loop. So until unless you don't stop it, we are not going to stop here. So I am just abruptly stop this one. So that is a keyboard interrupt. So this program, again, I will upload it. Not only this program, the other programs also, what we have done in the last week, that I will also upload those things on the course pages. So now I will make this this Pi available on this cloud server. So is there anyone who can, you are working on the laptop at present? Okay, Bharadwaj, I will now stop presenting from my side. You will be able to connect to this Raspberry Pi now. I will tell you what to be done. Okay.
Okay.
Right. So I'm stop presenting here now. So can you please present? You can connect to your laptop. Present to this.
Sir, is my screen?
Yeah. Coming. Yes. So go to the web.wildwoodin.studio. Okay, now you see that green color dialog box is come. It means your laptop is connected to that cloud server. Yeah, so I think some disturbance is coming, Bharadwaj.
There's some construction thing happening, sir. I'll keep myself muted.
No problem. Okay. So now you, I'll suggest you go to the application, open a new one. Yeah, create a new application now. Yes, this, of course, yes, you can go to the Python. Give a name to your project. Right, create project. Okay, now what you need to do don't go to connect now. Go to your session ID. Go to the menu item that is next to that. Yes, go to the session ID. Now remove the session ID, this one, and the session ID which I kept it in the chat box. You just copy that and paste the session ID there. All of you can take and copy this session ID onto your system. Don't connect yourself. Only one at a time can be connected. So that's what Bharadwaj is connecting it now. Later you will exit it. Then you can connect it back again. Okay. Now once you get again authenticated to web server, now you get the green color box. That is fine. Now you go to connect here. Now you can see NKS Pi 1. Yes, you are accessing the Raspberry Pi which is there in my home at present. So you can now go to the application, you can write the Python programs here directly, or you can go to the shell prompt. Go to the shell prompt. You can see on the right side of the shell prompt. Then just press enter. Yes. Now you are able to access the command prompt of my Raspberry Pi. And you can start writing the programs. Of course, this is just a first sample. And what programs have to be written here, I will give the list of exercises for you to practice it. So that's what you can get. If anybody else wants to connect it, then what I suggest is you have to exit here. How do you exit it? Please remember, nobody please click this disconnect button. If you click the disconnect button, then you are shutting down the Raspberry Pi and others cannot access that particular Raspberry Pi. So it is better you to exit it. There's a cross mark is there. Yes. On the right side top corner, there is a cross mark. You just exit from your system. That's enough. Yes. Yes, you can exit it. So once you exit it, you will come out of that one. But now others can join. Others can access the Raspberry Pi. Yes, if anybody else wants to test it once, you can please connect it. If you can access the computer from your side. What about Deepika? Can you able to connect your system?
Yes, sir. I am doing it now.
Yeah, you just, you know, Deepika is trying. Please kindly hold on for others. So like this, these Raspberry Pis, if more Raspberry Pis are available, then others also can take those Raspberry Pis. But only one at a time has to be used. Only one user can use the Raspberry Pi for doing some programming. Once you complete, you exit it, the other students can access that.
Should I share my screen, sir?
Yeah, for others, just to have some idea about how do they access the Raspberry Pi.
Is my screen visible, sir?
Yeah. Yeah, I think you copied that session ID, right? Yeah, fine. Please click OK then now. That orange has to change it to green color. Yes. Now you can. No, you are connected to the Raspberry Pi simulator. You come out of that simulator and you access the real Raspberry Pi now.
Should I exit then? Or is there some way to disconnect?
Not disconnecting. You better to go to create a new application. This is your some other application you are doing, I think, here.
Yes, sir. I have created a new one. This is the new one, but then I'm not able to come out of this thing.
Oh no, why you are using this schematic then if it is a new one?
So that thing just it just comes up even though I
okay, I got the point. Okay. You just exit it and come back again, please.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, create new application. Let's create project. Yeah, now go to connect. Yes, connect.
First session ID.
Yeah. Session ID. I think you have given already your session ID.
I think I have to give it again.
Yeah. Yes. You exited, no? Yeah. Now you will be able to access this Raspberry Pi. Yes. You can start programming here. You can just run the program which I given here now. Can I put the program here? Just run the command to display all the USB serial ports of my Raspberry Pi.
Okay.
Yeah, you can see here this ACM0. Is what the USB serial cable of my Arduino board, which is connected to the Raspberry Pi. Okay, now you can you write the serial write down? Open a new editor. Right. .py. Yes. Yeah, you can run it on your system. Can you able to see it now, right? Can you store those values in the file?
Okay, sir.
You can modify the program or you can take your own program there. Copy the same program to another file and you modify the program.
Okay, sir.
Okay, you can do it later, right?
Okay, sir. Yeah.
You can disconnect it. Oh, no, not disconnecting the Raspberry Pi. You can.
I'll exit.
Yes, exit. Just exit it. Yeah, you can. Yes. You can stop presenting. Yeah. Yeah, so like this, one by one students can, of course, the Anurag and Pranav also will make available their Raspberry Pis. So I will also keep my Raspberry Pi on all the time. So anybody who are interested, you can practice it. So I will tell the exercises to be done. Along with this, not only digital temperature, we can connect the other sensors and you can start playing with those things. And of course, the assignment two will be on this set of exercises. Okay, that is a practical demonstration for today. Any queries here at this moment?
No, sir.
So I'm presenting from my side. So okay, now let us move on to the today's topic discussion. See, the material is available on our course page, Introduction to MQTT. So what is MQTT and what is its purpose? And of course, we will try to understand why this MQTT has come into picture. See, if you might have recollect your own old traditional way of data communication, usually if you see on this diagram, can anybody tell me what do you understand from this diagram of this one? Yes, please. I'm referring to this diagram one.
OSLR?
Sorry? OSI. Yeah. Yes, it's basically your ISO OSI reference model, more specifically your TCP IP model. So how the data communication is happening between two different entities, two different computers across the internet. So what is the meaning you can infer from this particular diagram? So using your application layer protocol, your byte streams are being sent through these applications. It means your data is being prepared based on the application that you are going to have it, and the data is being passed through different protocols, your TCP and your IP. You know the purpose of TCP and you know the purpose of IP, and the data is again sent from one side, that is from the client side, to the server side, and that server side, once the server receives that data, again it is prepared onto the receiving side, and it is given to the application which is running on the receiving side. So this is how your basic data communication which is happening. That's what in the traditional, when the internet era has begun. So your entire information, like if you are sending an email, your email through your SMTP protocol, the information is being converted through your byte streams, and through your TCP and IP, that information is being put in a different formats. So can you tell me what is the purpose of TCP here in the OSI reference model or your TCP IP suit? What does the TCP does and what is the IP does?
So TCP is a transport layer protocol.
Yes, of course, TCP is a transport layer protocol. What is the main purpose of this? At least two, three features of TCP. Is it reliable or unreliable?
Reliable, sir.
Reliable. In what way it is reliable, data communication through your TCP?
Lossless data transfer happens.
TCP. Sorry?
Lossless.
That's what reliable means. Lossless only. Data is not going to be lost. How can you say the data is not going to be lost? Here you will have the acknowledgments. Please remember, for every TCP, you will have the corresponding acknowledgement for every packet that is going to be sent. And if that acknowledgement is not received, again a retransmission takes place. So unreliable data transmission is through which particular protocol?
UDP.
Yes. So you know what is the difference between TCP and UDP? Of course, the data is been made into that. What are the bytes that are coming from your respective application? It can be an email, it can be a video file, it can be an image file, or it can be just a file transfer, whatever it may be. That entire data has been converted into byte streams, and then byte streams are converted into segments by your TCP for reliable or unreliable data transmission. Then those segments are being converted into packets or your datagrams, which includes what? What is the function of IP? IP protocol. What does IP does?
Addressing and routing.
For routing, okay. Yes, yes. It is going to add your routes to your packets that needs to be sent to the right destination or to other side of your network. So again, when it reaches to the server of the target server, then again that particular packets are converted back to the segments. Segments are converted back to their bytes, and the bytes are being given to the corresponding application, as can be seen on the other side of that network. Means other side of that transmission, and that is data is received to the another entity or to the another user here. So these are your basic OSI reference model or the TCP IP suite is going to happen through byte streams. But these byte streams, now what happened is later our systems have been advanced systems, in the sense the technologies have been advanced. So these byte streams nowadays, what happens, you are seeing the data transmissions which are happening through messages. So now let us look into the right side of the diagram here now. So how the messages are being sent, instead of the byte streams, the actual byte streams data from one application to another application, the messages are being now sent across the internet, that is across the network with different users here. So how the messages are being getting transmitted nowadays? What do you understand from this second diagram here, please? Hello. Am I audible to you, please?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So what do you understand from this second diagram? There is a browser, there is a server. The browser is basically your... Sorry?
This request or response?
Yeah, request response. Yes, request response kind of a data transmission is getting... happened here over this kind of network technology. Basically, in this one, you have something called client server. So a client is one entity on the network which is trying to request some information through a protocol called HTTP, Hypertext Transfer Protocol. So your hypertext transfer data is been happening request, and that request is been sent to the corresponding server, and the server is going to give the corresponding response by giving if that data is available over there with the corresponding headers and the actual content that is present there on that web resources. That is basically from the web servers. So a request response is happening between your client and the server. Whereas if you see the old scenario, so the data is being converted to your byte streams through your segments, through your datagrams, your packets, and that is complete. So again, completely is happening in the reverse side using your TCP IP. Whereas on the top of the TCP IP, you have another protocol now, something called as HTTP, Hypertext Transfer Protocol. So this is what you can see, that message, the message from one entity, from one side to another side, from one client to a server and from server to the client, which is happening in the terms of request and response. This is how your message communications, the message data transfer is happening in somewhat in this today's technology here. But coming to the same scenario here, what happened is, if you look into the third diagram, because there are so many devices, millions, and of course, that's what is anticipated. You will be having so many millions of devices that are getting connected with each other. So when you are trying to communicate from one device to another, or from one machine to another, and that communication which needs to be happening either on this left side of the diagram or on the right side of the diagram is going to be a very complex task. So if you look into the left side of the diagram, your TCP IP suite, and to the right side of the diagram, your HTTP request and response. If you want to follow any one of these strategies to transmit data from one machine to another machine, it requires a lot of bandwidth, it requires a lot of communication capabilities, it requires a lot of time, it requires a lot of data handling processes. So instead of having a simple communication between one device to another device, a lot of computational aspects have been involved, either following the left side diagram, that is basic TCP IP suite, or onto the right side message communications. So Internet of Things themes and Internet of Things applications following this either of these two architectures or either of these two strategies is not a very apt one, because the devices that are getting connected with each other in the Internet of Things and the communication protocols that have been running on this Internet of Things is not supporting all these complex processes, either the TCP/IP suite or to your HTTP request response model. So if you look into this at that point, what I listed on here, just see here carefully, this is the old vision of data communication was based on reliable byte streams, that is through your TCP/IP suites. And of course, nowadays you are having message interchange in terms of your client server response models with respect to some applications like your Twitter, WhatsApp, Instagram, what you see, the social networking websites and other things that all are happening. Basically, some of them are happening with your HTTP request response mode, some are not happening with this, with the other set of protocols. That we will see it in the course of our discussion. So the request response paradigm is the reference model where you are having HTTP hypertext transfer protocol, which supports the REST technology, which also is basically something which is going to depend on something like a producer-consumer problem. Somebody is trying to produce and other person is trying to consume. So basically, producer is the one who is going to give the data and the consumer is the one who is going to get the data. So something like this, this particular paradigm, which is based on this producer-consumer paradigm, is what this particular protocols like MQTT is being followed here or is being considered here. So most likely, our Internet of Things applications do depend on this type of protocols, that is MQ telemetry transport protocols, rather than the old OSI reference models or your TCP/IP suites or your HTTP REST and the RESTless communication protocol. So before going to the MQTT protocol, let me again brief you about the serial data communication which is happening here. So that's the thing here. Please remember, you always connect your sensor device or your sensor collecting device or a sensing system to a logical device such as your gateways or to your low-end devices such as Raspberry Pis or Arduino boards. So whenever you collect data from the sensor, the data is being collected serially. Please remember, it is not parallelly. Can you tell me what is the meaning of serial connection here or a serial data transmission? As you have seen in just now, this application, what we have seen just now, you are using this particular program. Let me connect this program again. Most of the time, your Internet of Things applications, we see a serial data communication happening here.
Serial communication means sending one bit at a time.
Yes, this sending the data one bit at a time. So it is not in a parallel. So my internet problem. Oh, somebody else is using the studio. Please remember, I am just connecting it here. So you'll be disconnected, please. You can see it on my screen. There is another studio instance. Means somebody is using that. Please just hold on for a couple of seconds. So I'm just connecting here now. So connecting to the. Again, somebody has disconnected mine. So please just hold on for some time. Time being, so let us not waste time here. Please do exit from your application. So usually most of the time we try to collect the data in a serial way. May I know why we don't prefer the parallel way of connection while connecting the sensor data and collecting it and sending it parallelly? Why we collect the data like this? Please see here carefully. The serial connection is you are sending the data bit by bit. So bit by bit means one bit after the another bit. That's what your serial communication. Usually when you're transmitting it, so your timing signals, you'll be waiting for some time and you start sending the bits. So your bits are getting sent from one side, that is from the transmission side to the receiving side. And the bits are being transmitted in terms of bytes. That's why we say byte stream. So of course, in terms of byte means one byte is basically 8 bits. And this byte, before that one, you are having a start bit and you are also having a stop bit for each particular byte here. Something very similar, very generic nature of transferring your data from one end to the other end, from one device to another device. So basically, this is what your byte stream is. So my question is, why we people does not prefer here? Now I can just connect here. Just I'm trying to open this program. This program again, we have seen just the serial connection here. If you see, remember here. I will give you the user different types of users. So I already created one user there. So I'll give the users. Your assignments can be submitted in the users instead of directly giving. So other people will be copying here or something like that. So I'll give that application. So now you see, if you run here, you are getting the data here, one after the other only here, one sample after that other sample here. So that's what you see here. It is not happening in the palette. So let me just stop here and let me open the program once again. So here in this program also you are seeing something called serial. That's what we see, serial. So that's what the serial communication which is happening here. You are collecting the data in terms of bytes. Why we don't prefer for parallel? Anybody? Anyone can please give the answer? So, yes, please.
So there's a lesser chance for the bits to get mixed up. Like if it's a long distance transmission or something, if it's serial, then there's lesser chance for them to get mixed up.
Yeah. But yeah, you are on the track. I'm just expecting a right technical word here. That's what I need. I'm just a technical term that we need to consider here. The meaning is the right meaning only what you have said. It's so not like user, Listen.
If we need to transmit n bits, we need to have n bit channel dedicated to for the transmission.
So this is what he means to use in the parallel data transmission. When you are transmitting parallel data, you are from the sending side and the receiving side, then must be if you are going for the synchronous way, the n bits are to be there. N bit transmission means if you are transmitting 4 bits, for example, 4 bits at a time, then the receiving side also they should be capable to receive 4 bits at a time. So in the Internet of Things and Internet of Things applications, it is not always guaranteed the sender and the receiver should be both having the compatibility in sending and receiving for the synchronous data properly. So it is likely that the machines do not have the same types of architecture, same types of principles, same types of characteristics. So most likely those problems do arise. That's why your parallel data transmissions, only data that is being transmitted from your cloud to the fog nodes or to the intermediary gateways, you can do the parallel communications. But when you are talking about the sensing and the sensors or your actuators, you cannot go with the parallel data transmissions. This is very fundamental issue, and of course very important point also. Everybody should have the clarity in this very fundamental problem. So okay, now coming to this, now as we've seen, usually we transmit through the serial communication, that is the byte streams. So if you see here HTTP, that's what you see from your web browser. You send the HTTP request. You can see all these diagrams. Yes, please.
So like I have one doubt. We don't follow parallel kind of communication because of compatibility issues. So if one organization, one company is collecting data from a sensor, so it will prepare dedicated hardware chips. So will they follow parallel communication because it's limited to that specific use case?
Okay, so to make it more clear for you, please do remember this parallel data transmission can be done in the IoT things and IoT applications at different levels, not at the sensor data level. Please remember. So when you're collecting the sensor's data, because a sensor it is an heterogeneous, different types of sensors are being used, different people are manufacturing different types of sensors. So there is no as such a standard in what way there has to be have a communication standard between all those types of sensors. It cannot be standardized that the level at which you are collecting the sensor data. I'm talking about sensor means, of course, it also implies for the actuators to apply your data to be run on those devices. So here, that company, if they are going to, if you have a compatibility, the company is manufacturing all the different types of devices at different levels of IoT architecture. So if you see your IoT architecture, what are the different levels in the IoT architecture? Can you please recollect what are the different layers in the IoT architecture? Usually you have the basic layers.
Collection, storage, pre-processing, analysis.
Yeah, of course, this is collection, storage, and pre-processing. That is a very basic step. I'm talking about the, see, in IoT, there are three different layers. The bottom layer, you will have the sensing layer. If you have to talk in technical terms, you have to talk it like this. So at the bottom layer, at the low level, you have a sensing and actuating layer where a sensor collects the data. And at the middle level, what is the technical term you call it as? The architecture level. Of course, if you categorize in general, you have three different layers. One is the sensing or actuating layer. The middle layer is your communication layer. And the third layer is your data processing layer. So each in the sensing layer and the actuating layer and the communication and as well as the data processing, if the company manufactures all those devices, they can do the parallel communications. There's not a problem here. Anurag, are you getting this point, please?
Yes, sir. Yes.
So if you are following different communication standards in the middle layer, if you are following ZigBee protocol, if you are following Wi-Fi protocol, if you are following LoRaWAN protocol, these are different communication protocols for transmitting your sensing data. And those communication layers are not given by the same company. They are not being means protocol. They are not given those softwares to run those protocols. So usually it is an incompatible most of the time because you use sensors manufactured by some company, use some wireless communication protocols, you use some other data processing techniques for data handling things. So these are not compatible with each other. That's why you will not see a parallel data transmission do happening across all the different layers of your IoT applications. I hope you are clear with this one, Anurag.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so if you see here now the HTTP, you have a different HTTP models. You can see if you see any diagram, basically either your web servers or your data transmission or between your client servers, all these things are basically relying on the basic generic architecture which you have seen here. So on the right side of the figure, the same thing, generic architecture of your TCP/IP suite. So how this HTTP is happening for those students who are not clear about HTTP, once again, I kept a little bit of information here. See, whenever you type something on your web browser, something like this, you give a URL. So that URL is nothing but your request, which has been sent to a server via your URL. So what is that request? You enter something here, http://api.example.com/resources/users/ something like the actual variables data that you are trying to access here. So entire your URL, it contains something, this information here. This basically, this is what your HTTP, the RESTful. In this RESTful, can anybody tell me what is REST stands for? REST?
Representational
state transfer.
Yes, representational state transfer. The integrated MTech students, you already studied in your internet technologies course. So that is representational state transfer. That is the process which is going to happen here to retrieve some data which is available on the web server or to another server which is on the network, internet network. So usually when you get a response from that server, that response is usually either in the HTML contents or in the XML format or in the JSON format for you to exchange the data from your server to your client. So usually you, if you are asking something like what about push and a server wants to tell device to do something and all, that is not coming from the server here in this RESTful architecture. It means the server is not telling what to be done for the client. Your server is only serving whatever the request that is being made here. That's what your RESTful architecture is. A client is going to ask some data, the server is going to give some response. That's what your request and response model is going to happen over here. So that request and response model of your RESTful architecture, can you tell me what are the different types of methods this RESTful architecture do support? Anyone, can you please recollect this one? You should not forget these methods of HTTP methods. Yes, please.
Get method, post method.
Yes, get post. Only two methods. What are the other methods?
Put, delete.
Yes, put, delete, head. Yes, all these are very good. At least people are able to recollect.
Nine methods are there.
Yeah. So these are the RESTful architecture methods. Usually, when you this is basically when you're doing some web browsing and all, you always keep asking those things. It means you ask some data from a server. You get some response from the server, either in the HTML content form or in the XML content form or in the JSON content form. I think everybody knows what is HTML, XML, and JSON content. So if you are going to apply the same process, the same strategy for your Internet of Things, if you apply it, what is going to happen, you please see here. So if you're applying the same RESTful, that is the architecture, suppose you're asking from your cell phone, if you're asking means you're giving a request to turn off a particular light or a bulb in your home from your office. So using your mobile phone or your cell phone. So you are telling, if your all your bulbs and all your devices information is available and is being connected to your server, and you are issuing a command using your URL, something like api.example.com/turnoff, and that command is coming from the server of your home, to switch off your lights of so-and-so light at so-and-so room and so-and-so device using your Wi-Fi networks of your home. So usually that steps is given here. So from your cell phone, you are sending the request as an URL, and that is being processed by the server, and the process is going to give that response by switching off that corresponding light of your home, if you are following the RESTful. Can anybody tell me what is the disadvantage of this kind of architecture, the RESTful architecture, if it is followed for IoT things or IoT applications? If you are following the same RESTful architecture, yes, please.
Security, sir.
Of course, security always will be there. Security is apart from security. What are the other things that you need to consider, or other things that needs to be handled properly here?
So because the intruder or middleman can change the part of the URL and can get what he wants.
Was yes, okay, acceptable. Apart from this?
So since most of the IoT applications are on infinite loops, then the server will get too many requests.
Okay, the request will be, yeah, more number of requests will be there. That is fine. Okay, any other things, please? Why that architecture is not preferable for IoT applications? Again, I'm putting still the answer. I do not get the right answer, actually. You are revolving around that, but your answers also are to some extent right because of the technological considerations, the security and the complexity and the number of connections. That is okay. That is technically valid, but that is not the main problem with the IoT things. There is still a burning problem is there if you are following this RESTful architecture of requesting and getting the responses to be done. I just want you to think in this direction, please. Still, you know the answer, of course. You know the answer. I'm just waiting for 1 minute.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
So, delay in processing response?
Delay in processing response? Yeah, it all depends on the your server capabilities and all. Yeah, you are revolving around the answer only, but you are not given the exact answer what is being expected here. If you are looking to the IoT applications only, IoT things, Internet of Things. Still, I'm expecting the right answer. Yes, please. Okay, I will put forward the other question in another way. So suppose if you are going to please remember again, you are forgetting one important point here. Your IoT devices are dash constraints. I have given the hint for you.
Resource constraint.
Very good. So what do you mean by resource constraint, please?
Processing capabilities.
Yes. So here, if you have a machine, if you want to have machine to machine talk with each other, and if you are having a communication requirement, something like this, to process the URLs, the requests and the responses, your IoT devices do not support this kind of a little bit of complex tasks because their resources are very much constrained. They do not have the processing capabilities. They do not have the storage. They do not have the bandwidth. So this, I hope you got the answer now. So your IoT devices are not capable enough to process, to communicate, and to store the values if you are following the RESTful architecture or the REST architectures. So to overcome this one, something called as MQ telemetry transport. Of course, most of the in the old literature, some people call it as MQ stands for message queuing. But technically speaking, you do not utter the abbreviation of MQ as message queuing. It is in changed. You can just simply say MQ. MQ telemetry transport. So because there is a communication capabilities are very low in these kinds of IoT devices, so your RESTful architectures do not support very much on your resource constrained devices. So IoT applications have now come up with some another protocols. That's why we call it as IoT protocols, MQTT. MQTT is one of the IoT communication protocol to exchange data between in IoT most of the time you are exchanging the data between
server and IoT device.
Don't say server and IoT devices, it is between device to device. The device can be a server or a gateway, but most of the time you are machine to machine. Please remember, machine to machine, either in the robotics, if you say in the robotics or robots also, you'll have a machine where you are having resource constrained devices with less processing capabilities, less memory, less communication bandwidths. So you have to talk with machine to machine with less processing capability, less memory, less storage. So that's why in the RESTful architectures and other TCP/IP suites, they require a lot of processing capabilities, a lot of memory, a lot of communication bandwidths. To overcome all those constraints, this particular MQTT protocol has come. Where this MQTT, the working principle, the principle behind this MQTT is something called as publish and subscribe. The terms, they call it as a publish and subscribe. This publish and subscribe terms is not something like your producer and the consumer. And of course, this publish and subscribe events are going to happen with the help of a broker. But now this the term broker is there in the last decade, and people have changed this broker terminology to called server. Now people call it as a server itself. But more specifically in the old terminology, old means in the last decade when MQTT is in the beginning stage of this IoT, they call it as a broker. So you can call it as a broker, you can call it as a server also. And when you call it as a server, the other side is called as a client side. So basically on the client side, you have devices. So these devices are nothing but your MQTT clients, we can call it as. So that devices, which means hardware devices. You can also have the application sites, your application, your programming sites, they're also application, they're also called client sites. Of course, if you are using the communication protocol of MQTT, you can call it as MQTT client. So MQTT client devices sites, what they do is the device, the sensor device, the sensor data is published, is sent, is been given. That is an event. So whenever you have that sensor data collection, the sensor data collection is being stored or it is being kept in the particular service broker site, which is going to service. And whenever some other, this is what you are published. and the other devices do subscribe. Subscribe means they collect the data from this server. They are going to collect it, or they are going to use it. So this is what a little bit the different architecture from the RESTful architecture or your HTTP architecture. So here the terms we use something called publish, subscribe, and broker. These are the three different terms that you need to understand here. So this broker can be somewhere in the cloud, it can be there, or somewhere in your gateway itself. As a Raspberry Pi can be made as a server for you, as a server to collect the data and to process it. So this is what the architecture looks like, MQTT, publish, subscribe. So publishing your sensor data, basically sensor data is being stored onto the server, and the other applications or other devices, which are resource constrained devices, do subscribe the data that is available on the server as and when it is given, or as and when it is available on the server, which is coming from different client sites. So this is what a simple architecture, that's what MQTT. If you look to this MQTT, the history background, this is basically coming from the IBM. So in the way back 1999, of course, the internet era only it has come. So the, basically the basic purpose is, because this, whenever you try to communicate, whenever you try to exchange the data, some energy is also spent for your exchanging the data from your client to the server or from your machine to machine. So basically, when you follow the RESTful architecture, the communication exchange is going to be very much high in terms of their packets, in terms of their connection establishment, in terms of their acknowledgements, in terms of so much of bandwidth is being used. And along the bandwidth, you also spend a lot of energy. But in the IoT applications, where the devices are been having power sources with the batteries, battery is the very powerful source here, powerful ingredient that is required for your IoT applications. So batteries do not give you a lot of energy. It is, they are having limited energy only. Mm-hmm. And if that limited energy is just spent for communication purpose, there is no point in following that RESTful architecture. So this is another important point that needs to be done, needs to be known here. So this MQTT has come, which is come with for consuming less energy in terms of having only less communication exchange between the publish and the subscribe through the publish and subscribe model between the client and the broker, or between the client and the servers. So where this MQTT's use case was to create a protocol for minimal battery loss means battery energy consumption, and minimal bandwidth connecting oil pipelines or satellite connections. The goals of this one is to be very, to have a simple to implement, provide a quality of service data delivery. It means it should be reliable data transfer, delay should not be there. So it must be lightweight and bandwidth efficient. That's what you should consume, less bandwidth. It can be very fast, of course. And it should be on the data agnostic rather than the communication. It means it should data, you should focus on the data transfer rather than the communication establishment, communication disconnections, communications replenishments, and other things should not be considered here. Only the data is the most important thing. And continuous session awareness. Whenever data is being published, it should be subscribed here. So that is the main purpose of MQTT coming into picture. So along with MQTT, there is another protocol called COAP, Constraint Application Protocol. So these are the two protocols for your Internet of Things applications, for your exchanging of data. Please do remember this. So let us little bit dwell upon on this MQTT protocol. So MQTT protocol follows a publish-subscribe model. So basically all clients connect to a broker. So that's what you can see it on the diagram. Your clients can be either devices or your applications. They always connect to the broker. That broker means basically, technically speaking, that is a server. So clients subscribe to topics. So if you see here, what is a topic? Topic is another term which is coming in this MQTT protocol. So topics means basically you are going to have each and every entity of your home, something like your lights, your fans, your another electronic devices, or other non-electronic devices. If you want to interact with them, they're all being given as different topics here. So something like this, you can see client is going to be subscribing to the toggle light 1, toggle lights 2, or toggle light 3 in your home, different lights. All these have been, lights are been termed as a topics here. So clients can publish messages to topics. So topics is light 1 is one topic, light 2 is another topic. So basically you want to switch on, switch off, either to make it on and off, toggling between those two different states can be happening here. So all clients receive all messages published to topics they subscribe to. So all the clients will send those data, the data which is related to those topics, and the topics are keep maintaining on the broker, on the server, so that the other clients can subscribe to those topics. And whenever there is some instruction is been given, that is in the form of publishing, an event is happening here, the corresponding instruction gets executed on the necessary, on the respective clients here. So the messages can be anything. It can be a simple text message, it can be image, it can be an audio, it can be any multimedia data that you want to interact with. So those messages are going to happen. So the same thing now, if you see here into the previous diagram with respect to RESTful architecture, which has been followed by the HTTP. So here the cell phone gives an instruction, something like cell phone being a client, it is publishing the instruction. It means it is giving an a request, the light switch one to be toggled. That is what the request is being made to broker, that is to the server itself. So once it is toggled, means it can be on and off. If it is on, it is going to be off. If it is off, it is going to be on. That instruction is given to the broker. And whenever this Wi-Fi switch of your home is connected to this server, is getting that instruction. Once it gets the instruction, the instruction gets executed by following that it, you know, what the instruction is. So if you look at the comparison between MQTT and REST, so basically the REST follows your client server model. So here, this is what the REST, your post, your REST, that HTTP post or a put or a get method. So the client, if you are going to communicate from one client to the other client, so these are all the steps that needs to be followed. The REST, it follows the hierarchy, the REST architecture, followed by the HTTP, followed by the TCP, followed by the IP, again through the internet to the other side of the network. And again, you get back the responses, connection establishment and connection session establishments. So a lot of communication bandwidth is being utilized if you are following this HTTP model here. Instead of this one, you have publish subscribe model. So if you see here, the publisher is the source, the server is the broker, we call it as in the MQTT terminology. And the subscriber is another client which is going to subscribe or which is going to act accordingly based on the instructions that is given from another client or from a machine to machine. So basically MQTT is meant for machine to machine communication. So that is most viable using less communication steps, less communication. So bandwidth is being, less bandwidth is being used, less energy is being used as the less bandwidth is used. So if you see here, a publisher connects to this one and gets the acknowledgement, that is enough a reliable communication to happen here. And the subscriber, whenever the publisher gives the instruction, the subscriber, because it is connected to this broker, that immediate instruction is going to be executed here. So instead of having all the payloads that needs to be added for each protocol to communicate using REST is being avoided here, so that less energy consumption, less bandwidth, more reliable and data agnostic operations do happen through your publish subscribe model rather than RESTful architecture. So this is what a quick information for you. It will be useful for you to understand. So please remember, using WebSockets also you can do you using your MQTT protocol. So what is a WebSocket? What is a WebSocket, please? May I know something which you are aware of? What do you mean by a WebSocket? Yes, please. Any idea about what is a WebSocket is? In your communication or your operating systems course, you might have already heard or already listened about this.
So it's a connection.
IP address and the port address bind it.
Yes, please. IP address and the
port address, that is binded, where we can connect and transmit data or exchange
data. Okay, let me just show you once again here. All of you, please look to this, what this WildRootin Studio is doing actually. So let me just once again and connect to this. So please observe it carefully here. So this is a browser. Through the browser, I am giving a request web.wildrootin.studio. Now I get a server error here. But after some time, you might have observed that it comes to green color. When it comes to green color, what exactly was happening there? Can anybody tell me?
It's trying to connect to a socket.
Very good. You observed that rightly. So what is that WebSocket is? So that WebSocket, you are this web.wildrootin.studio is a server which is there in the cloud, which is there in the internet. And your browser, that is what you are. Sorry, WildRootin Studio is a?
SSH port.
No, it is not SSH port. It is not an SSH. See, now the green color dialog box has just left. Then once my browser, see what happened is my browser here, I am connected to the cloud here, connected to the cloud server. That is WildRoutine Studio server. Once I connect to the cloud, then only I was able to, because I made my Raspberry Pi to be available on the server. Now I am able to access it. Once through how it has happened is through WebSocket only internally. That is nothing but you call it as WebSocket. So please, everybody should understand what is a WebSocket is in Internet of Things applications also. That is going to be very much useful for you, a lot of applications too. Okay, now this is one scenario which I've just quickly observed. From your browser, the browser what I'm using is the Chrome browser. Chrome browser supports your WebSocket connections. Please do remember. So the web through the Chrome browser, I'm connecting to this server. So once it is connected, that's why the socket connection is established. And once the socket connection is established through this session, in this session, there is one Raspberry Pi made available to be accessed. That's what it is actually done here. So let me just give you a little bit more on this WebSockets here. So that will also be useful for you. So Chrome supports your hypertext transfer protocols, secured, as well as your file transfer protocol to transfer your file contents, and as well as WebSockets. So Chrome does not support MQTT, but MQTT can be run over through the WebSockets. And what is WebSockets? Thus, let us understand a little bit on this. So here you are making a socket. What is a socket is? What do you mean by socket?
It's like a connection between two processes.
Yes, a connecting point. That's all. Yes, it is like a plug point. So once you make a plug point, you can connect, your electricity can flow. You can connect to that plug point. Once you connect your microphone or any electronic device in your home to a particular plug point, the electricity flows through that plug point. That plug point is nothing but a socket. So the name also has come into that particular point, this socket, almost 30 years back. So here the socket is being established between the client and the server. So that's what the WildRoutine Studio, that is the server here, whatever the URL you are seeing here, web.wildroutine.studio is the server. So your client is nothing but your Chrome browser here. The Chrome browser is establishing an connection to be opened, and you get the response. That's why a WebSocket green color light is coming here. And your of course, you disconnect it, your channel is getting closed here. That's what your simple WebSocket to a particular port, you are connecting to that particular address. So here, this is what the port number is. The web server, a simple program on the server side looks like this. So you, whatever the clients are there, you are going to connect all your clients, all these browsers. Not only my browser, you can also connect to this web.wildroutine.studio. It's another server. Again, through a WebSocket only. Through WebSocket means from your browser, you connect to that server here. Those are all different number of clients. And in each, when you connect it with a different session ID, you are able to access this particular Raspberry Pi from the server. So this is how the small program looks like between the server and the client of your WebSockets. And we can still use MQTT in the browser. The connection is handled via WebSockets. And this eliminates a lot of the housekeeping requirement because you need not take care of how to establish a WebSocket connection to a web server. So that's what the Chrome can do for you. And of course, this is a many-to-many communication. You can do the two-way communications, can also easily happen. So this is how you are connecting from your browser to your web server using to a particular port here. And once you connect to that particular port, you can see here the client is on, a connection is established. And once the client is subscribing to a particular channel, you can put some topics. Topics means your information can be stored. That is, you are publishing to that particular channel. That is nothing but what you are publishing is this: the data that is going to be stored on that channel here. These channels can be different types of topics. It can be lights, it can be fans, it can be anything of your any physical entity of your IoT applications. So then when the client is on, you can keep logging on these machines, what are the things happening. So that on the server, you can keep monitoring what are the connections connected and how the things are happening here. So one assignment I'm going to give to you. This is on the broker. So of course, if you let in the next class, since the less number of people are there, I will demonstrate this onto the Raspberry Pi only. On the Raspberry Pi, you can create your own broker. That is, you can create your own MQTT server, and you can connect to that MQTT server through your client and see how your MQTT protocol is working. So MQTT protocol basically works with commands called publish and subscribe model. And if you don't want to have your broker onto your Raspberry Pi, you can also connect your broker to a cloud. So you have cloud servers are available to you, like DigitalOcean. And of course, Mosquito organization, they have their own free open source clouds MQTT server. You can download and you can install it onto your Windows machine. So same, this protocol can be run either by installing the server and client onto your Windows or into your Linux machine, or you can connect to the cloud servers and you can understand how the client things goes on. So when you are giving the information, so that is what your channel or your topics is, you can give that information something in the form of a hierarchical structure instead of a flat file structure. So in your home, you are on your ground floor, in your living room, what is the temperature, you can give it like this. You can give the commands and instructions on your publish and subscribe model by following different syntaxes that we will see it in the next class. You can something like this, the same hierarchical path, like you give in the URL, same thing, you can give it in the URL for interacting, for interaction between different components or different devices of your IoT things. So if you are following the Mosquito, you can have your own chatting applications through that. One example I'm just showing, you can go through this mosquito.org website and you can see this. You can go to these websites, the digitalocean.com and the broker, and as well as the broker in mosquito.org, and you can see how those applications are running here. A simple snapshot. So those, you can use it to interact with you in your home also. If you have the electrical bulbs, or of course those bulbs are not directly can be used, you have to program it. But you can buy these bulbs on the Amazon with Philips company have their own Wi-Fi bulbs are available. If you want to automate these things in your home along with the Raspberry Pi, you can do these things. So basically you follow the JSON style of writing the data using the MQTT protocol. And we'll see one of the how to connect it to this on the Tuesday's class with the Raspberry Pis. So this is what just let us see in the demonstration what is publish and subscribe, how the commands are to be executed. And of course, Arjit, I think, is not there in today's session, but he has given the demonstration for some of those in the FDP program that we recently connected it. But nevertheless, I will give the demonstration for you in the Tuesday's class. So I'll just, any queries here, I'll just stop the presentation. This material is available on our Moodle course pages. You can start reading these materials. You can start preparing for the minor exam here for the next Sunday. Yeah, any queries, please? So this Raspberry Pi, I will keep on. Keep it on and you can start programming here. So I request Anurag and Pranav, are you having any class now after 11 o'clock?
Yes, sir.
11 o'clock. So when you'll be free?
After 3 or 4.
After 3, you are free, Anurag. What about Pranav?
Same, sir. Yes, sir. Because, 3, sir.
Okay, 3 o'clock. Then I will connect once again through the Google Meet, and you make your Raspberry Pi. Just keep it ready with connected to your laptop, and you have your SD card with you, right?
Yes, sir.
Can you do you have the card reader with you? The SD card reader.
Yes, sir. Sir, our Raspberry Pi, like I already installed OS in it.
Yeah, but we are going to install a OS with some additional packages.
Oh, okay, sir.
See, once you install these additional packages, your old OS will go away.
Okay, sir.
So it will be better you keep a backup of your SD card, both of you, okay? Or if you have any other SD card with you, that will be easy for us, so that we can keep that SD card for these experiments, for this Wildwood studio to be connected. That will be more apt one.
Okay, sir.
So if you have already some existing programs here, please take the backups and keep it aside, because you'll override this OS with other additional packages.
Okay, sir.
That I will tell you, okay? And keep the SD card reader with you. That's only, just it'll take another 15 minutes or the maximum 20 minutes time for you, okay? The demonstration I'll tell you, so that those Raspberry Pis are also going to be made available here. We will do that.
Okay, sir.
So we'll meet at 3 o'clock, okay? So just if you both are together available, then please ping me up and I will connect it, okay?
Yes.
Yeah. So now is I will just send a message to all of you regarding the minor one exam for the next Friday. So just hold on, and if you have any queries, please let me know. Please inform to your friends also. I'm just with whatever the email IDs are there with me, I'm just sending the messages to all of you. Is it on second only, no?
Yes, sir.
Any other doubts, please? Yes, please. Any other queries? If not, I will wind up the session for today. We will meet on again on Tuesday. Is it okay?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, please take care of yourself. Stay safe. See you on Tuesday. Okay.
Okay, sir.